lift it up. Father, I pray that he would be glorified. Lord, here this morning. Again, how we thank you, Lord, for all the things you have done for us. Lord, many that we so take for granted. Lord, we thank you for those things. And Lord, we ask again this morning that, Lord, you'll meet this need of our heart today. Thank you for every person that's here. Lord, we pray for those who could not be here today. Lord, some unable to be here today, but Lord, here we are. And Lord, we're praying that you'll give us, Lord, a blessing for having come out on this Lord's day. Help us, we pray now, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right. Before I give you a chance to ask a question, in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, Jesus really, people have often wondered, what is, you know, the Sermon on the Mount? What is it? You know, some have suggested, well, it is the rules for living in the kingdom. And, you know, people have different ideas about it. But I want to say this quickly, and then we'll move on. Jesus said this, "You're the salt of the earth." Chapter 5, 6, 7. "Ye are the salt of the earth. Ye are the salt of the earth. And the salt is lost to savor wherewith it shall be salted." We talk many times about how the culture in America is being destroyed. And really is being destroyed right before our eyes. And we have, you know, we talked about several Sundays ago about the transgender thing. And if you don't know, North Carolina passed a common sense law that said whatever you were born, that is the bathroom you have to use. I think it is somewhat telling that the person who is pushing the transgender bill in North Carolina is a sexual predator. Now, here's the thing. North Carolina is under a tremendous amount of pressure to rescind and change the law. People said, well, we're not going to do business with North Carolina because they're bigoted. Well, I don't know what's bigoted about it, but here's really what it is. Our culture, our Christian heritage is under attack here. And if North Carolina gives in to the pressure, what we now have witnessed one more time is our culture being destroyed. Because you know how it is when any group, and it doesn't matter who it is, they complain loud enough and long enough, and eventually, if they're anti-God, eventually they seem to get their way. We've talked about the whole the lesbian, the gays, the transgender, the bisexuals, all those people, they only make up like maybe 2% of our society, but you'd think they made up 30, 40% as loud as they are. Every time people give in to the pressure, then we've witnessed our culture being destroyed just a little bit more. And how many times have we seen it where somebody passes what we would consider to be a common sense law, and then the anti-God crowd cries out about it? I saw this week. There is a National Day of Prayer in America. I don't even know when it is, but it's National Day of Prayer. The atheists are pushing Congress to have their own day. I don't know what you would call it, but, huh? Yeah, every day is their day. April Fool's Day. There you go, Dave. Very good, very good. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. But what we see, and it's not like all this stuff happened, boom, but slowly but surely, we are seeing the effectiveness of the saltiness of Christians slowly being eroded. if Christians in America would rise up and were as loud and vocal, but you see, we're not that way. We're not going to march on Washington. If every person who claimed the name of Christ showed up in Washington, D.C., want to be the most massive traffic jam you could imagine, but it might get their attention. But we said, well, we don't want to rock the boat. We don't want to say anything. We need to stand up for the truth. Now, we don't want to be offensive to people. We don't want to be unkind. But if our position is offensive, then so be it. But we are watching that occur right before our eyes. And I have this sinking feeling that North Carolina is probably going to give in. As you know, there are other states that are trying to do the same thing, and they will come under tremendous pressure from the anti-God crowd to change the law and not make it. But again, we just say this. All the law in North Carolina said was that you know, if whatever you were born, that's the bathroom you've got to use. I mean, how much more common sense can it be? But we are considered to be bigots because of that. Well, if I'm a bigot because of that, then so be it. Then that's what we are. So anyway, we're the salt of the earth, but we are slowly. And, you know, then people say, well, what do you think is going to happen in America? Well, the hand of judgment is going to fall. If the hand of judgment of God, we talked about this last week. What is the judgment of God? It can be economic. It can be disastrous as far as natural disasters are concerned. It can eventually, you know, what did God do to Israel? He put them in bondage. And I realize we're not Israel, but who knows what God would do. And so, you know, we're just seeing that to the point where, you know, as it was with Lot, when Lot went to his sons-in-laws, it seemed as he mocked them, made fun of them. So, all right, anybody got a question today? Anybody got a question about anything today? If you do, I'll surely try to answer it. If not, we're going to move on. Go on once. I can't believe no one has a question. All right, then we're in Galatians. Huh? John's not here. Yeah, John's not here. All right, Galatians. Galatians, and we are in chapter 6. Last week, we were talking about the verse that be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. And, what is it, 2 Corinthians, talking about the law of reaping and sowing, and it is a principle in the Word of God that what you sow, that is what you're going to reap. And the Bible says in 2 Corinthians, it's either chapter 8 or 9, one of those two, he which soweth sparingly shall reap sparingly. That's why we've said many times it's impossible, it is impossible for a person to outgive God. God will bless you one way or another. God will, you know, if we put him first. Dave was in Malachi on Wednesday night, and one of the verses, and Malachi is a series of questions, but one of the questions is, will a man rob God? Will a man rob God? And the answer to that is, well, of course a man wouldn't rob God. I mean, who'd rob God? There ain't anybody rob God. Yet the Bible says, yet ye have robbed me in tithes and offerings. And he says, prove me now herewith, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that you cannot contain it. Luke 6:38, given it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, running over, shaken together, shall men give unto your bosom. Listen, God has a way of providing for us. And that's what God does. God does that. But if you're going to be cheap with God, then I guarantee you God's going to be cheap with you. But if he which soweth, if you sow sparingly, shall reap sparingly. But on the contrary, if we sow bountifully, God will meet our needs. I may not meet everything that we want, but God has promised to meet the needs that we have. Now, it says there in Galatians chapter 6, in verse 7 there, be not deceived. We kind of take that in a negative context. Be not deceived. God is, because it says God is not mocked. And any country, any person, any church that, you know, says, well, you know, we're not going to do it God's way. Well, let's do it God's way. But it is kind of a negative verse. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. But verse 8. Read that soweth to his flesh, shall the flesh reap corruption. But, he that soweth to the Spirit, shall the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing. Now here is a positive negative, if you want to call it. Because the Bible encourages us not to grow weary in well-doing. You say, well, why is that, preacher? Because the natural tendency is for us to grow weary in well-doing. It's easier to do nothing than it is to constantly be doing good. So it says, number one, don't be weary in well-doing. Don't be weary in well-doing. It's easier to do wrong. Everybody can be a critic. Everybody can be a critic. Let's be positive. Let's not be weary in doing good. The Bible says that as we have opportunity, let me see if that's, verse 10, as we therefore have opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. So, as believers, man, we ought to be doing good to everybody. Everybody. But especially to those that are saved. Brenda. Go. Right.
Well,
if you're doing it as unto the Lord, just forget about it.
Okay. All right, let me say the first thing about what Brenda said.
I think this is about my kids. Do your children ever struggle? I'm talking, even if you're grown. Well, if you've got children, you're grown. But I mean,
even if you're older.
If you're older and your kids are gone, do your children struggle? Sure they do. Do you want to help them? Sure you do. I do. But I'm going to say this about me personally. Carol and I have talked about this. I love my kids. I love my boys. And two of them do really well. The other two don't do as well. I love Tim. I mean, Tim is special. But at times, I feel like I have enabled him to keep going in the direction that he's going. That I cannot tell you how many times I bailed him out. I said to Ben one time, don't ever ask to borrow money from me because your brothers have already blown it. One time Tim said, if you co-sign for this car, I'll pay for it. I'll make sure I pay for it. Well, you know who wound up paying for it. dad did. You know, and it's like, I have enabled him time and again. Now, we need to be careful about that. Matt?
Classic example. Prodigal son was only enabled one time.
Right.
The prodigal son was only enabled one time, if you didn't hear what Matt said.
I know when he came home, there was a big party, and et cetera, et cetera. Brother Howell had a sermon I only heard ever one time the day after the party. There was a party that night. But the day after the party. Now, we need to be careful, and people call the church all the time and say, hey, you guys give out money? No, I don't know how they say it, but that's what they're asking. They say, do you help people? And here's what I always say to them. Brother Fielder says this, we have a benevolent fund, but we don't have any money in it right now. And he said, the truth of the matter is they never had any money in it because they wouldn't. Because people call here and say, do you help people? And this is what I always tell them. I tell them, well, here's the way we do that. If people come to church, we will help them. If you'll come to church, in 36 years, how many people do you think have taken me up on that? Zero. Nobody has ever come to church. And then, you know, I hate to do this, but sometimes I get irritated. Why did you call me? Why did you call me? Well, I called other churches. You're just the first one that answered. And it's like, well, why did you wait until you were in such a predicament to call me? Well, I don't know. And I just tell them, and I just say to them, well, look, if you want help, and I say, well, how much do you need? About $800. If you want help, if you'll come to church, we'll take an offering up. Nobody's ever come. They don't need, they don't want God. They don't want God's help. They just want a handout. Now, I've said many times, I am not against helping needy people. I am not. I am against helping greedy people. And basically, in the society in which we live, there are a bunch of takers out there who will take anything that you can give them. And I'll remind you of what Paul said, that if a man doesn't work, then he's not going to eat. I've told people before, all right, if you come over here and work, I have one guy one time stop and say, I'm on my way to Norwich. I had car problems up in Governor. I don't have enough money to get home. He said, could you help me? I said, I've got a bunch of wood around back to stack. You go out there and stack it, and I'll give you money. He went out back and stacked it. I felt pretty bad. I went out and helped him. And then I gave him $15 so he could get home. That's the only guy in all the years, really, that has ever shown any interest. I'm not against, and we ought not to be against, helping people who are truly needy, especially those of the household of faith. If there was somebody in our church who was in really bad straits, really needed help, there's not a person in this church that would not do something to help them. I know that about this church. I know that about us. But again, you know, Brenda's thing is, well, and it's like I loved him. I know that he struggles from time to time. Him and his cousin Alex were out in his Jeep. They were on government property and got stopped. And Tim and Alex both said they were innocent, but he still got a $250 ticket out of it. I felt like sending him $100. But all that does is enable him. He said he was innocent. And Tim was always innocent. Aren't we all? That's right, aren't we all? I didn't do it. You know, it's like the guy standing there over the dead body and the gun's still smoking. I didn't do it. You know, it's like that. But on the other hand, and we need to be careful about that. Do I love my kids? Yeah. Do I want to help my kids as much as I can without enabling them to go down the wrong road? But if there's a brother who is in need, then we need to do good. He said, well, I've, you know, tried to. And Ken brought up, well, suppose you do help a brother, and then they come back and say, well, I need help again, and 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 I need help again. Well, there are certain principles. One, is the person watching, you know, I don't even know what soap operas are. I don't even know if they still have soap operas on TV. You know, I don't even know if this is on TV. If he's home watching As the World Turns instead of out trying to do something, if he's home watching TV and drinking Cokes and eating cake and ice cream and chocolates all day, I'm going to be very leery about giving him money. If he doesn't work, he doesn't eat. You say, well, what if he can't find a job? I'm going to tell you something. I'll be honest with you. Where was I just at the other day they were hiring? Where? Everywhere. Look. Yeah. If I had to flip hamburgers at McDonald's, you know. Good money there. I'm just saying that I understand that sometimes people are physically incapable because of life situation to be able to work. I understand that. God knows that. But if a guy is able-bodied and he doesn't want to go out and get a job, then I'm probably not going to enable him, Brenda. I might. He said, well, I don't have any money to get to work. Well, I'll give you $25. No, I'm not going to give you $25. I'll put $25 in gas in your car so you can go to work. If you give him $25, probably go out and spend it on something. But the principle here that Paul is talking about is that as we have opportunity to do good, we'll say like Pete over here or Dave. They need their grass cut. As we have opportunity to do good, let us do good. You know, I'll cut your grass for you. I'll cut your grass for you. See, that's doing good. Suppose you're sick. I know that people from time to time get sick, and that the ladies in the church kind of organize to take meals over. That's opportunity good. They're sick. They've been having an operation and haven't been able to do anything. Okay, so let's do good to them. We're not talking about supporting for the rest of their life. We're talking about doing good as we have opportunity to do good. Let us not be weary in that. Let's not be weary in well-doing. See, okay, we get tired of it. Well, man, I've helped them some. People only call here like once or twice, and they finally get the idea. You know, when they call here and say, well, I need my electric bill paid, and I'm serious, people, I say, well, how much is your electric bill? It's $800. I'm thinking, what did you do to run up an $800 electric bill? No, they didn't pay it. Yeah, that's it. So now they want us to pay it. I am not really, really inclined to do that. Because I'll guarantee you, once somebody says, you know, that church over there paid my electric bill, now everybody's going to be calling and wanting us to pay their electric bill. If someone in our church has a need, bless God, we're going to do everything we can to help them meet that need. If somebody came and said to us, preacher, I know such and such, I hope you don't think I'm cold about this, but our society and the way everything is set up, man, people can pretty much get help. And so I'm not too inclined to help people that just call me up, ask for money. I'm just not really inclined to do that. But if a brother calls up and says, "Preacher, I need help." Sure. How can we help? And we'll do our best to do that. I say again, do not ask to borrow money. If you have a need, I'll just give it to you. If you want to give it back, fine. But don't ask to borrow. It's not a good idea to do that. So as we have opportunity to do good, great. Let's not be an enabler to those who won't do for themselves. Let's not do that. But as we have opportunity to do good, let us do good. As it says in that verse 10, especially to them. So there's a negative. Let's not be weary in well-doing. Because this is what it says. For in due season we shall reap. If we faint, the word there does not mean to fall over. Faint there means not to give up. Don't give up. For in due season we shall reap if we faint not. So the question is this then, really for us today, if we are not weary in well-doing, and if we don't give up, if we don't grow weary, if we don't give up, because one, we'll grow weary, then secondly, we'll give up. It's the progression. Let's not be weary, because if we get weary, we're going to give up. So if we, you know, what's Isaiah? What is that verse, Isaiah? Is it 40, 39? 41? What is that verse? But they that wait upon the Lord. 40:31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So if we're, you know, trusting in the Lord and asking Him to help us, let's not grow weary. That way we'll not give up. We're going to reap. So now the question is this. What is it that we are going to reap? What will we reap? What is it we're going to reap? Anybody got any idea? What will we, if we do not give up, if we do not grow weary and give up, we're going to reap. What is it we're going to reap? Arnold?
Souls.
Souls?
Peace.
Huh?
Peace.
Peace?
Blessings.
Blessings. Peace. Souls. Sometimes being good to lost people will lead them to Christ. Now, I'm not going to mention any names, but you can probably figure out who this is. Being good to lost people will sometimes cause them to see what it is that we're all about. You know why Christians don't scream and yell and carry on high, and why they don't blow up banks, and why they don't blow up police stations, and why they don't shoot policemen? And because there's something different about us on the inside. Lost crowd, they're of their father, the devil. If we do good to one another, you know, say, well, thank you. If you do good for lost people, and we have tried to help lost people before, and you can probably say, well, preacher, I know where it did. We have helped lost people before. We've taken them meals and done things for them. And it didn't do anything at all. Now, I'm not saying, and I'm not disagreeing with Arnold in this. I'm just saying that doing that, but we'll reap blessings. I don't like the idea, well, we'll feel good about ourselves. But we'll get the blessing of God upon our life because, you know, if you give, it shall be given unto you. I mean, that's just what God's going to do. And so we're going to reap. In due season, we shall reap. May be that we'll reap souls. It may be that we reach a brother. It may be any number of things that we're going to reap in heaven. Even a cup of cold water, and this is what's so amazing, even a cup of cold water given in my name shall receive will receive a reward. I can't tell you, because nobody really knows, I can't tell you exactly how all the rewards are going to be given out. I have an idea. But if we give a cup of cold water in the name of Christ, hey, here, in the name of Christ, I want to give you this. Bible says we're going to get a reward for that. I don't know how that will be, but I know that we will. And so let's not be weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap reward. And people say, well, I'm not doing it for the reward. That's great. But I want you to know that Christ offers rewards for the things that we do. I realized it was, back in the Stone Age. And my dad at times would give us an allowance, 50 cents a week. Even a dollar today isn't very much. I thought this the other day, this week. We have bus safety drills this week. I said, I'll give a dollar to anybody. Maybe I told you this. I'll give a dollar to anybody, first person with their hand up, who can tell me when the Declaration of Independence was written. First answer, 2010. No, it wasn't 2010. 2014. No, it wasn't 2014. Was it 20? No, it wasn't. Some kid in the sixth grade eventually got 1776. I give a dollar. It was a dollar. Dad used to give us 50 cents. And then he upped it to a dollar. Then he didn't give us anything. And then he gave, but anyway, for what? Doing what you're supposed to do. Lord is going to give out rewards. Christians ought to be kind. What's Ephesians 4:32 say? Be ye kind one to another. Be kind. Just be kind. Forgiving one another. How many, and I know probably everybody raised their hand, but how many have ever been taken advantage of? Sure. I'm not going to ask this because I don't want to know. But you think about it, how many have ever been taken advantage of by another Christian? You don't need to raise your hand. But you say, well, and so then we go back to this. So what? You live long enough, there's going to be a lot of people take advantage of you. So, Kim?
It's hard to do, but when you were talking about, helping whether they're lost people or Christians, you do have some kind of an expectation whether they appreciate it or lead them to salvation or whatever. But we're not called to do that. That's the Holy Spirit's job to do that. We're called to just plant seeds and then give it to God and let Him do what He does with it. And it is difficult to do that, but when you do it with that, the heart of, okay, God, this is what you want me to do, it does put a lot of pressure off of us as Christians too.
Absolutely. That's the point. This
leads us to this. Why do you do what you do? Are you doing it to be seen of men? Or are you doing it so that somebody might get a blessing? Be not weary in well-doing. I was going to say something that you said, but couldn't have been important. All right, back to Galatians. Let us not be weary. So there's a negative there. Don't be weary. Don't faint. Don't be weary in well-doing. Don't faint. We're going to reap. We're going to get something. I don't know what it'll be. Maybe just a blessing of God. Maybe that God just pours out a blessing on us. The Bible says this, that He left us an example that we should follow in His steps. I think there's a verse. that says this about Jesus, that he went about doing good. That's what he did. When he healed the blind man, when he healed Bartimaeus sitting beside the road, do you think he healed him just so he could get something from him? Absolutely not. Or when he healed, raised Lazarus from the dead, or the widow of Nain's son, or Jairus' daughter, why did he do what he did? He did not do that to get some kind of remuneration for it. He simply went about doing good. And so that ought to be a principle in our lives. What is it that I can do for somebody? What good can I do for somebody that would be a help and a blessing to them? And then leave it up to God. Alex?
I think sometimes we're kind of belligerent when it comes to helping other people because with all the prosperity preaching and everything that's gone on, people, they do something and they think that the next day they're going to get, you know, reimbursement from heaven.
Absolutely.
For it. And that's not the big picture. The big picture is, okay, you may not get something immediate. You may not, you know, get what you thought you were going to get, but I think if you look past that, you're going to grow as a Christian, and that's the bigger blessing that you're going to get out of it, is you're going to grow and get to that next level that you need to be at.
It increases your faith.
Ryan?
I also think the opposite too, because people nowadays are so leery about why you would do anything for them. Even right. Just in the respect of being honest, I don't know how many times I've been honest with a cashier or turned in something, and they look at me like I have a third eye, because why would you be honest? You just, right. You would have gotten away with something.
That happened to me this week. I was at Walmart, and I bought all my gladiola bulbs had gotten old, so I bought some. And what else did I buy? I bought something else, and it came to $11. I grabbed it. I walked out the door and said, that isn't right. And then I looked, and there was an $11 item that the person had not charged me for. So I'm already out the door. Now, all right, I just put $11 over on Walmart. Wait a minute. Your Heavenly Father. So I turned around, went back in, and said to the girl, hey, he didn't charge me for this $11 item. She is like, so? I said, here. And being honest. Now, Alex was saying something before Ryan interrupted him, but you're right. I mean, people look at you. What do you want? I was telling Carol the other day, Carp and I went visiting somebody one time, and we're there. You know, when you go and talk to people about Christ, most of the time, you know, they're kind of... We went to some old girlfriend's house. Now, right there, that tells me there's probably going to be trouble, but we went to an old girlfriend's house somewhere outside of Carthage, and she recognized Bob and went in. Her husband's there, and, you know, and... He's sitting there, and Carp starts in. Now, you know, Bob's always, and he's going on. After about 10 minutes, her husband just kind of stood up and said, what are you guys selling, Bibles? You know, that kind of attitude. You know, Bob said, no, we're not selling anything. He said, well, so then the guy goes, just leave. But, you know, people are very, what do you want? What is it that you want? But Alex mentioned something about the health and wealth. If you've ever been on Facebook, I saw one last night. If you repost this, within 24 hours, you're going to get a large sum of money.
But what if it's true?
Well, here's one guy that'll never find out, because I am not going to do that. It's just... Brenda.
I gotta say, this is funny too.
That happened to me in Walmart, and I went back, because they didn't charge me for something, so I went back with the $11-something, and I went to customer service, and I said, you know, you didn't charge, funny, that's 11.
Yes.
So she says, well, I don't know where to put it. So I didn't say anything, and I just said, well, that's your issue.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like, are you kidding me?
Right.
Can you imagine how many people must leave there with not being charged for stuff?
Right. Now, if you knew that, and you went back, and you told me, hey, look, you didn't charge me this, and they said, whatever.
That's between them, but, I mean, you've cleared your conscience before God. I mean, and that's, listen, I would, Carol has gotten more than one soda out of the machine. I don't know what it was one day, pushing the machine, man, the soda just kept coming out. You know, we could have been handing them out to everybody in the parking lot, you know, but she went back in, she gave them all to the people. You know, being honest today, you know, people, what's wrong with you? Being honest, as we have opportunity to do good, let's do good before it lost ground. They won't understand it. They won't get it. I would have just kept, people say, I'd have just kept on walking. Well, I know you would have, but I'm not going to do that. Let's be honest. And if you click that like button for get a large sum of money, remember the preacher, amen? So, you know, Alex was talking about the health and wealth philosophy of today. Okay, look, I want, you can get the wrong idea if you want. It's okay, I'm not going to care if you do. But what's that guy's name? I know who it is. That's him. Thank you. Joel Osteen. He has a $40 million church. He has his own private jet. Lives in a big mansion. And, you know, well, if you give me money. And there are a lot of guys like that. You know, send me money and the Lord will send you, you know, that idea about planting a seed. Well, plant a seed and you'll reap a harvest. So send me $20 and God will provide you a whole bunch of money. And you get enough people sending you $20, you're going to add up some real money after a while. And, you know, I just look at things like that, these health and wealth guys. In Isaiah, where it says this, and we kind of got off, but that's all right. In Isaiah, it says this, with his stripes we are healed. Now, spiritually speaking, we are healed, but I hear guys preach that, well, nobody ever ought to be sick. And if you're sick, it's because of a lack of faith. Well, the truth is that everybody's going to get sick and die. You know, everybody dies. You know, and it question is, you know, is it your turn? But everybody dies. Well, the guy shouldn't have died. If he had enough faith, he wouldn't have been sick. Well, that's ridiculous. Everybody dies. But they have these health and wealth guys, and there are people. It's like the Facebook thing. How many people do you think actually type amen and repost that, expecting that they're going to get a large sum of money within the next few days? If people didn't do it, then they probably wouldn't be up there. But I guarantee you there are people who are looking, you know, to get rich. Desperation. Anyway, okay. Anybody else got a... All right, then we are going on. We didn't talk about the health and wealth thing all day, but I will say this. I want to repeat this, that if you want God to bless you, learn to give. I've repeatedly said, when you get to heaven, you will not be sorry for the $20 you gave to the missionary or the $50 you gave to the evangelist. or anything like that. You will not be sorry. You'll never say, boy, I wish I hadn't given that money in church. You'll never say that. Never say that. Let's go on. We got to go on. We're almost out of time anyway. All right. Paul says in verse 11, you see how large a letter I've written with unto you with mine own hand. Paul may have had eye problems. Remember, Paul prayed this. Prayed three times. He prayed, Lord, remove this thorn in the flesh that I have. And Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for thee. Whatever the problem may have been. And I'm serious when I say this. Some believe that Paul could not speak clearly. Some believe that he had a serious eye problem. Some think he was a short, ugly guy. Who knows what the problem was? But here's what God said. My grace is sufficient for thee. Whatever it might be. My grace is sufficient for you. Whatever your problem may be. Whatever your burden may be. My grace is sufficient to meet the need in your life. Boy, that's one of the great things about being a Christian, that we have some place to go. We have someone to talk to. You know, a lot of times, all somebody needs is an ear. All sometimes somebody needs is somebody to talk to and tell them their problems. Now, don't sit there like, are you done? You know, you see, some people you ask, how are they doing? And you know they're going to tell you for the next half hour how they're doing. Some people, I hesitate to ask them, but sometimes, somebody called me yesterday and was on the phone with me for an hour telling me about their problem. Now, did I have other things to do for that hour? I sure did. But as I saw it, that person probably had nobody else they could talk to. And so, when you and I say, well, I don't have anybody to talk. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. The Bible talks about thrones in the Bible. There's the throne of wrath, the throne of God's wrath that is going to be poured out one day. On this earth, there is the throne of God's holiness. But when we come to God, in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. God, grace. Let us come to the throne. That's where we're coming. Because there we have and somebody who wants to hear my problems, who wants to hear my concerns, who wants to hear about what's going on in my life. Look, God is interested in every little bit of, I don't want to say it like this, but God's interested in every little bit of minutia in your life if you want to talk to him about it. Guys, say this. Most of the time we're gone all day. We're around semi-intelligent people. I'm not going even there. Sometimes wives are at home with kids all day, and when they come home, they just want to talk. That's all they want. They want to talk. They just want to talk. That's what they want to talk. Are you done yet? Are you finished yet? I'm not saying this in a bad way. Really, I'm not, because I know you'll go and tell her anyway, but it's like, Carol comes home and tells me some of the stories that go on with her during the day. I just listen. Because sometimes that's what people need. They need somebody to listen. And I'll say this, fellas. I'm going to say, I don't care how old you are. If your wife has a problem, most of the time, she doesn't need you to fix that problem. Now, sometimes she does. But sometimes all she wants to do is tell you about the problem for you to hear the problem. men have this idea, because men are linear in their thinking. Women are circular in their thinking. I've said this before, and I don't mean this in a bad way. I can tell a story in 30 seconds. It takes Carol 10 minutes to tell, because women are circular in their thinking. Men are linear in their thinking. They go, okay, boom. All right, here's your problem. This is what your problem is. They don't want to hear that. They just want to hear someone to listen to their problem. I don't know how we got to listen. Oh, I know. We're talking to God. We're talking to God. We're coming to the throne of grace that we might find help in the time of need. That's what I need. I need help. And that person who called me yesterday and talked to me for an hour, they weren't really looking for a solution to their problem. They just needed somebody who was willing to listen. And sometimes that's all we need to be, is a good listener to somebody's problem and not try to solve the problem for them. Now, if they ask for, hey, I need to know what to do in this, this person started out, I don't know whether I'm crazy or not. My thought was, yeah, probably. But I don't know whether I'm crazy or not, or it's just the people I work with. You know that old saying? You know, you're talking to somebody. I'm talking to Dave. Everybody in the world's crazy but me and you, and I have my doubts about you. And so it's like, you know, I said, well, probably. And then they proceeded for the next hour to tell me what was wrong. I didn't have any real solutions to the problem. I just listened. Now, the Bible says there in verse 11, you see how large a letter I have written unto you with mine own hand. Paul's had a problem. It's probably his eyesight. He couldn't see very well. And, you know, made it clear, Paul said, I wrote this. Now, as many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. Here we come back to the whole thing about the book of Galatians. Was, are we saved by grace, or are we saved by keeping the law? Are we saved by works, or are we saved by grace? You know, we often, Matt and I were talking about this the other night. Every religion in the world can be summed up in two ways. Do or done. Most religions in the world, well, you got to do this, and 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 you got to do this. And I've asked people before. And we got to. But I've asked people, we're going to say, how do you think you get to heaven? And they say, well, you got to do this, you got to do this, and do this, and do this. I said, okay. Well, if that's true, then if you do that, will you guarantee me that I will go to heaven? Well, no, I can't guarantee you that. Well, then why would I want to do that? But with Christ, with grace, it's done. It's all done. It's finished. He said it's finished. And so Paul comes in verse 12. Of chapter 6, he comes back to the very thing that we started Galatians about. Works versus grace. Let me end with my favorite verse. And if it be of grace, then it is no more works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it be of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, work is no more grace. The grace of works. We've got to stop. Father, thank you again, Lord, for another great day. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here one more time. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that you've so wonderfully bestowed upon us. Thank you, Lord, that we have someone to come to. Thank you, Lord, we have someone to talk to who is willing and wants to hear our prayers, who's concerned about the everyday areas of our life. Lord, who is interested in me. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, bless us, help us as we have opportunity to do good to all men, but especially to those of the household of faith. Bless now, we ask, as we continue on and we'll thank, praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen.